It's exactly a month after the Indian Air Force planes went and struck a Jaish-e-Mohammad camp at Balakot, located in the Khyber Pakhtunkhwa province of Pakistan. It's been a tumultuous 30 days in the subcontinent. India proved its point by going deeper into Pakistan territory than ever before. In fact, in the 48 years since the 1971 war, no Indian Air Force fighter plane had crossed the line of control with Pakistan-occupied Jammu and Kashmir and even beyond. So, in a way, the strike on the Balakot camp of the Jaish-e-Mohammad is a paradigm shift as far as India's military strategy is concerned. How did that strike take place? Who planned it? What was the planning? And what was the force structure that was decided when the Indian Air Force was given the permission by Prime Minister Narendra Modi and the Cabinet Committee on Security to take revenge on the Pulwama attack that had happened on the CRPF convoy on 14th of February in Jammu and Kashmir? Here is what we know in 1 month since the Balakot strike happened. First, the Indian Air Force was told that Balakot is the target. Why Balakot? Because the Indian intelligence agencies homed on to the largest terrorist camp that Jaish-e-Mohammed runs at Balakot. Why is it largest? Because at one point in time, there are at least 300 to 350 terrorists undergoing various kinds of trainings in the Balakot camp. It's on a hilltop and away from populated centers in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa. Indian intelligence agencies got together a lot of human intelligence reports and matched it with the satellite images that they were acquiring from different sources of both ISRO satellites and friendly countries which were providing a lot of intelligence which was asked for. Having concentrated on Balakot, now it was up to the Indian Air Force to choose the force package it would use to target Balakot and the facilities in that large camp. Now, Indian Air Force was given this go-ahead and was told to choose its own, platform, the type of bomb that they would use, and how many aircraft would go there. That was left to the military itself, once the political decision was taken. So, what did the Indian Air Force do? It decided that it needed to use deception, it needed to use low altitude flying, it needed to use the terrain masking, and also catch Pakistani Air Force or their air defenses by surprise. These three elements actually decided from where the Indian Air Force will take off its planes which are going to attack Balakot, what kind of equipment they will carry, and what would be the composition of what is called a force package that the Air Force wanted to deploy for this attack. Now, this is how it happened. Having decided on Balakot, images were acquired. And the Air Force needed images which had resolution of less than 50 centimeters to have a precise and accurate information about the structure, about the layout of the camp that existed in Balakot. Now, having acquired those images through various sources from intelligence agencies, from ISRO and their own aerial photography, the Air Force decided that it will use the Spice 2000 bomb, which had been bought specifically for this kind of a task from Israel because of the particular speciality that this bomb has. The bomb was fed with the images of the camp that were acquired by the Indian Air Force. They were fitted onto six Mirage 2000 aircraft, which were chosen for this particular attack. And it was decided by the Indian Air Force in consultation with its pilots, with its image specialists, and of course at the highest level of leadership in the Indian Air Force and the national security management structure, that a particular day will be chosen to hit at the Balakot camp. Now, this is how the Air Force did it. They chose 12 Mirage 2000 aircraft based in Gwalior, which is in central India. Now, out of these 12, 6 were to carry the bombs. Each aircraft was to carry one bomb each. And four others were in air defense role. Two were in the EW role, electronic warfare role. So a total of 12 aircraft were chosen as a force package to go into Khyber Pakhtunkhwa. Now that is where the ingenuity and the kind of deception that Air Force wanted was achieved. Now the 12 Mirages were based in Gwalior, and before the date of execution of that plan came, the previous 4 days the Indian Air Force kept increasing its tempo of its sorties along the western border with Pakistan. So from Jaisalmer in Rajasthan right up to Srinagar in Jammu and Kashmir, the Indian Air Force planes and different planes kept doing night sorties, kept flying very close to different airfields inside India to give an impression that India was practicing certain things and looking at Pakistan's heartland, that is Punjab and of course Sindh, as a target. The practice run or the mock run went on for 4 days. Even as those mock runs were being conducted, the Air Force planes took off post midnight from Gwalior, went north towards the Himalayas. As we know, the Himalayas are like this and Pakistan is here. The Himalayas go like that, and this is Khyber Pakhtunkhwa somewhere here. This is the Pakistan occupied Jammu and Kashmir. Now this is JNK. So the aircraft went north and flew west as they hit the Himalayan boundary or the Himalayas. And from here they started going west. Somewhere above Himachal Pradesh and Uttarakhand, between that, Indian Air Force refuelers were stationed up in the sky, where they refueled these 12 Mirages. Top up, they did the top up, as they call it. They topped up the tank so that they are not short of fuel when they go into the target area. And once this was done, they were flying low, so there was no chance that the radars or the AWACS of the Pakistani Air Force would pick them up here, because this is quite a distance. They went west, came to the Jammu and Kashmir area, and even as they were crossing the line of control, the Mirages climbed to more than 30,000 feet. So they suddenly climbed here and then went about 50 kilometers beyond the line of control. Now this was Balakot, for instance, let's say. They did not go, all the Mirages did not go right over the target. They had the standoff capability. The spice bomb has a standoff capability of 60 kilometers. So they went almost 50 kilometers near Balakot, and from here they released six different bombs. Six planes released six different bombs and just came back from there. Even before the Pakistani Air Force or Pakistani radars could pick them up, it was a matter of 7 to 8 minutes of operation of going in, releasing the bomb, and the bombs then are on their own, because they have been fed with the GPS coordinates, the images which are fed into the bomb, and the bomb just go and hit the target that they have been fed with. So they went, that the Mirages returned, came back and came to Gwalior just as two F-16s were apparently scrambled from one of the mainline air bases inside Punjab province of Pakistan. But because all these aircraft were flying here, and we had, the Indian Air Force had kept the Sukhois along the western border as a defensive screen, the F-16s realized that they are not going to catch these Mirages which had come, or whichever the intrusion that had happened from the Indian Air Force. And here they dare not come towards India or inside India, because there was a defensive screen of the Sukhoi 30 aircraft which was kept all along the western border, even along the western LOC, the line of control. The Sukhoi 30s of course were playing the role of interceptor, and once the F-16s realized that they were outnumbered and they had no chance of intercepting the intruding Indian Air Force aircraft, they just went back there. So without any opposition, The Mirages went and released the bombs. The bombs went and hit the four buildings that were there, which were identified. And these bombs have a speciality that they go straight like this, make a pinhole. If this is a roof, they will go even 80 centimeters inside a roof, even if it's a concrete, reinforced concrete roof, they will go in, and after going inside, explode with 70 to 80 kg of explosives that they have. But they have one more speciality, these bombs. They have the incendiary material, which once it goes inside a building, inside a roof, just explodes, it creates shock waves, and it also raises the temperature to nearly 1000 degrees centigrade, which means if anybody who's sleeping here, occupying this place, will be just completely burnt. So that's exactly what pinpointed accuracy was observed. The pinholes were observed by the Indian Air Force planes and the satellite imagery. So four buildings were targeted, and according to the Indian Air Force, they achieved their target. So what was the target? The target was, as I said, four buildings in that complex. The four buildings had different levels of people living there or sleeping there. The time chosen was also chosen with care, because at about 3 a.m. in the morning, most people are asleep, no matter what kind of work they do. And different buildings had different levels of leadership. So there were some top leaders, there were some trainers, and there were, of course, the masses or the cadre, which was in larger number. So all these buildings were targeted. The Air Force has got the pictures, and I have seen some of those pictures, which shows the destruction of the roof and the pinholes, which appear exactly the point at which the bomb made the impact. And the bomb had the desired kind of a result, where the occupants were probably incinerated. We will never get the exact figure, because the exact figure is not known to anybody. It was all a matter of collecting different information, and with a process of elimination, making sure that the maximum number of terrorists were then sleeping at that point in time in those camps. Having achieved that, we know what happened exactly. The Air Force planes came back, and at 5:20 in the morning that day on 26th of February, I got a first call that there's something big has happened. Please be ready for big breaking news. Sure enough, as I started scouting the social media platforms, at 5:35 a.m., the Pakistani DGISPR, the spokesperson of the Pakistani Inter-Services Public Relations, actually tweeted that Indian Air Force planes intruded into Balakot in Muzaffarabad sector and dropped some payload without causing any harm. Just let's not get into what he said. The very fact that he admitted right in the morning that Indian Air Force planes had intruded into Pakistani airspace and beyond the Pakistan occupied Jammu and Kashmir, that itself was a very big news in the context of India-Pakistan. Because all along, ever since both countries went nuclear in 1998, so almost for 21 years, the Indian Prime Ministers, Indian decision makers have hesitated to cross the line of control. The Indian Air Force was not allowed to cross the line of control even in Kargil, when it was imperative to actually go and hit some of the camps on top of those peaks in Kargil and Dras. They were not allowed, because there was always a fear in the mind of Indian decision makers that if Indian Air Force escalates or Indian Air Force goes and hits inside Pakistan, there could be a danger of escalation and nuclear weapons might come into play. This fear in the minds of the Indian decision makers has been vanquished with the Balakot strike, and that is the biggest gain. What happened after that, claims, counterclaims, the dogfight the next day, is all irrelevant as far as I am concerned. As a strategic analyst, the biggest gain in this Balakot strike was that India crossed a red line and set a new red line, and said that if Pakistan allows terrorists based on its soil to hit Indian targets, India will not hesitate to use conventional military platforms on a specifically intelligence-based operation to hit terrorist camps. And that's exactly what was made clear in the statement read out by Foreign Secretary Vijay Gokhale, who said it was a non-military preemptive strike on terrorists. It was not targeted at the Pakistani military or the Pakistani citizens. And that's where I think the importance of Balakot lies. When we look back, maybe 20 years later, we'll realize how significant this milestone has been as far as the strategic calculus is concerned between India and Pakistan. Rest is a matter of detail and nitty-gritty, which we can talk about some other time. But let me say this, that the Indian Air Force has proved its worth, that it can do an operation assigned to it with precision, with accuracy, with professionalism, and get the desired results. That's the important takeaway from that Balakot episode exactly a month ago. This is Nitin Gokhale signing off at the moment, but keep sending your feedback, your comments, and maybe some suggestions if you have in doing this kind of an explainer that we would do occasionally when the situation demands. Goodbye.